John with Scan of the Month. This month, we're going to look at the evolution of the Nest learning thermostat. And to help us go through the evolution of the Nest, we have a very special guest, the creator of Nest, Tony Fadell.
Thank you. Thank you. It's great to be here.
Awesome. Let's take a look at what we have here. The first one that we're going to look at is the original first generation Nest. But I think the place to start actually is where a lot of your customers started, which is with this wiring plate.
Exactly. The big thing that happened, and one of the innovations we did at Nest, besides revolutionizing the thermostat, was revolutionizing the installation of the thermostat. Because at the end of the day, almost all thermostats were installed by professionals. I use that term loosely, but they were so complicated that you had to have someone, because they had dip switches or they had jumper plugs and all mm-hmm. kinds of other stuff. What we want to do is remove all of that. We wanted so that anyone could install it. We still thought it was going to be still daunting. But if we made it really easy for a general person to install, then it would be really fast for a professional.
Right.
So that's how we started. And we did all kinds of crazy engineering things on this to be able to do that. One of the biggest things, besides the cool the level. Now let's go into some slices.
There we go.
All right, good. Yeah, there it is. We can see it, and that's the level.
Huh.
The first thing was the bubble level, right? When you're putting something round on the wall or even square on the wall, did you get it right?
Uh-huh.
Because if you get it a little off kilter, well, then the whole screen would be off kilter. So we want to make sure it was right. So we want to make sure, and you can see the slots on there. The screw slots, which weren't holes, but they were slots, so you could do a little bit of orientation stuff. So the first one was making sure it got mounted right, but then, most importantly, was making sure we got the wiring right. And so let's go in here. And these are very special custom connectors on this.
Uh-huh.
And what would happen is they could detect when a wire was inserted or not inserted, but they would also make and break contact on the board. So if we go into certain ones of these connectors, the little leaf springs in there. And this was a real, no one knew we could pull this off. I didn't even know. I was like, I think we can, but I wasn't sure. But I was like, we're going to try. And so there's little springs in there. So one was, like I said, to tell you whether or not there was a wire inserted in there. But when the wire was inserted, it would break other electrical contacts. So it would change the PCB.
Yeah, yeah.
You're each time. So depending on the configuration. And then it could send that to the main unit so that you didn't have to program it and say, this wire is this and this wire is that and change these things. It would do it automatically. So it was self-configuring. It would self-identify based on what you did physically, and then it would self-configure based on that. So it was a really intricate back and forth design, and it worked. and these connectors were all custom. Everyone's like, this is crazy.
Yeah.
But it worked.
Let's take a look at some of these in 3D. I think I've noticed they're really impressive. What we're gonna do is look at the CT scan and
there's the leaf springs.
Take away some of the plastics and then zoom in on these leaf springs.
Oh, you can see them.
Look at the complexity of those springs.
Exactly. So this was this crazy mechanical thing. And you can see some on the back of some of these connectors, there was one or three kind of mechanical things, and each of them were associated with wiring on the plate inside here for how it was going to get to the mechanical connector that went back up to the top.
Uh-huh.
Because this was, you couldn't just use this and you couldn't just use this. You had to have both of them together to complete the circuit board. It was like literally the two circuit boards were here and then you put it together. Now it was a complete product.
So it's not even a software logic thing. It's just the circuit is actually being assembled.
Yeah, yeah,
when you put it
together. In some of these earlier ones, that's how it was. It became much smarter over time.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's how it began.
Yeah.
First and foremost. So it's really great to see these connectors and how much we struggled and how much we paid to design them. Remember, we were a little tiny startup,
uh-huh.
and we didn't have crazy funding. We weren't Apple, and so to go and spend, I think it was $250,000 on custom tooling of these connectors, custom labeling of the connectors,
uh-huh.
making different versions of them. that was like unheard of, right, for a little startup to
right,
do.
Right, right.
So that was, you know, those were the kind of crazy things that we did to pull it off, but it worked. And
yeah.
It worked for a great reason. It wasn't just for, you know, for our egos or whatever. It was
right,
like, it was really important for the user.
Makes it a great product.
It made it for a great installation product. Like, if people would install it, put it on, and it worked.
Yeah.
And it was so simple that we had grandmothers doing it. And they would make videos, YouTube videos, and go, I did this, check this out. So we had like 70-year-old grandmothers installing them, and they felt like they were young again. They're like, look at what I've done. It was so fun to see those videos, and it was heartwarming, right? Because you put all this love and care, the whole team did, not just me, but the whole team put so much love and care in it, and then for other people to then experience it, it's really, it's magic when that happens. So let's move on. Let's go on to the interface.
Yeah, so let's take a look at the thermostat itself. Here we've got the overview on the CT scan. This has a plastic skirt sort of around the sides,
yep,
along with a brushed stainless steel ring here.
A brushed stainless steel ring. And then it also has the grill on the front. So it has this crazy grill. Oh, and here, look, check this out. So this was the other trick. If you look at, here's the LCD, right?
Mm-hmm.
See what's happening with the LCD?
Chamfered.
Everything was cut because we were like, well, we could use a square display or a rectangular display, but then the diameter, because it's circular, was going to grow this much more.
Right.
And we're like, no, it has to fit in the palm of your hand, or in between your fingers, and feel good. And you didn't want it like this, because then it doesn't work very well. So we're like, oh, that feels right. So it's like, well, no one had done it before. We asked the LCD suppliers, well, you got to cut off corners. And they're like, what? No, we want you to cut off the corners. They're like, well, we'll try. Another crazy thing for a little startup, right?
Yeah.
And this was a custom display, all that stuff. And again, it worked. But that's what made it, what was necessary to pull off this design aesthetic, because it had to be round.
Right.
It had to be round, because all you needed to do at the end of the day was turn it up and down. That was 99.9% of the time was all you were going to do is turn it up and down. You didn't have to do anything else. But the other cool thing, so what was really interesting here, and you can see it, is, and these are these little springs around the side.
Mm-hmm.
You can hear it click. So it wasn't just turning, but it was, and we had to design that too. How to get it to click from any angle. If you want to press it like this, you want to press it like that, you want to press it like this, you want to press it like that. So how do you get that same click feeling regardless on how you do it? And you can see it here in the scan, how we did it with these kind of crazy springs that would then connect to another board, which would then push a button.
Uh-huh.
So it was always the same button.
Wow.
So it was our mechanical team was just insane. It had a great time. We had all kinds of prototypes just to get, so just like we did on the back plate, but you wanted to make sure it had to be just like, no matter how I tried to do it.
Yeah.
And I was like, you guys are geniuses. You pulled it off.
And it makes it accessible, right? Because then it's not something where you have to know how to push it. You just push it and people
will
push it.
You just push it regardless of how you do it. But there's no mushiness.
Right.
And it's always high quality. If you remember thermostats back then, or even today, because they still sell them, they're crap.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you know, they were beige or they were gray, and then they started yellowing. They still do that today. It was like, mm-hmm. no, we're going to do this differently, right?
Yeah.
And so so that was it. We had the grill here to get more airflow into the sensors, and we used different sensors to be able to detect when people were near it so it could turn on. So you would come near it, and then it would light up.
It greets you. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just high, right?
Yeah.
Versus it always being on, and maybe it's in your bedroom or something, and it's like, why do I have this thing with big numbers always on all the time? We wanted to hide it into the background, and something that was beautiful on your wall that you could always see, as opposed to like, you know, these plugs or whatever.
Right,
it
right,
is.
Right. I think we've got a close up of the sensors. If you hit this.
Let's do it.
Yeah. Thermometer.
Thermometer detail. There we are. So, you know, that was the other thing we had to figure out was because the electronics would get hot. So you had to figure out the electronics heat versus the room temperature, the electronics temperature versus the room temperature. And how do you get that to get right and making sure that there were no kind of craziness craziness in that. That was an interesting.
So there are a lot of electronics in here, a lot of RF stuff, right? And this was before the rest of the Nest ecosystem, you know, the smoke detectors and so on existed. So this was also looking ahead to an ecosystem.
Absolutely. Well, first, great point. So we had Wi-Fi in here, right? Mm-hmm. So Wi-Fi was in there, and you're like, okay.
Sure.
But one thing it had in there is a Thread radio. Now, you may be hearing, people are hearing about Thread today, now in home electronics or home IoT kinds of products. And it's now a big standard. But at Nest, we actually created this Thread standard.
Huh.
We created it and implemented and everything, and we worked on it for, not just me, but the whole team did, and beyond me, they kept working on it. And now it is the de facto standard in Apple products, Amazon products, Google products, across the board. Now you're hearing everything about Thread. Well, guess what had Thread in it at way back when?
Before there was even anything else to thread it to.
Exactly. Because it was always like, you're going to put this on your wall and it's going to be there for 10, 12, 15 years.
Right.
You don't want to, unlike your phone, and maybe we shouldn't do it either, you're going to replace it every 18, 24 months, something like that. Well, you're not going to replace your thermostat like that.
Right.
So you want to make sure you have designed, you know, you have designed a lot into it so that you can use it over time and that you know, over a long time. It's kind of like a video game machine. You get a PlayStation 5 and you can use it for 8-10 years and it's got a lot more capability because it's all about the platform.
Right.
Well, that's what this was about. Was becoming that So that is the first generation. That's the first generation Nest.
So let's take a look now at generation 2 of the Nest. This came out just about a year afterwards, right?
That's right.
So you improved, you changed the product a lot. You kept developing.
As always, right? And you can see the biggest difference is going to be, and you can see it here in the scan, which is an all metal ring on the outside. Not just this little one, but this big, giant, heavy one. The other one is, look at that.
It's a huge difference.
And you know, also, we got rid of the grill. We put in a different type of sensor for a presence detector sensor. We also were able to get better airflow in, so you could get the, you didn't need the airflow for the temperature sensors here as well. So all of this stuff got improved. You can still see the chamfered LCD in there. We had a different connector inside. We even changed the USB port. We even made the leaf springs had to change, right? Because you only had one way to press it. So we got rid of all, this was an incredibly genius design. It's kind of like the iPod first gen where we're like, oh, it's a mechanical wheel and everything. This is still mechanical, but we removed all those extra parts to be able to still get that same great feel, but without like $2 or $3 extra in all the other componentry. So this was clever, but it was a little too clever.
Yeah.
Right, so we were able to simplify it, make it smaller, and just so much nicer. Still had the same radios, some of the new architecture like that, but it was really about we figured out what we didn't do right, and we went and do it. We even made the backplate even smaller and those kinds of things. So it was a full rev.
So let's take a look then at Gen 3. This came out a couple years later,
Gen 3 came out a couple years later.
Product maturing here.
Absolutely. And one of the great things on the Gen 3, as you can see, it's slightly smaller than the Gen 2, but the screen is incredibly big, right? If you look at it, and we should get into that, we should get into the LCD here.
So if you slide this over, you can pull away, right? So
look at that.
Pick that up.
Now, when we look at it, it's not chamfered on two edges, it's chamfered on four edges. And that's even harder to do,
right?
To be able to pull off without changing the diameter. If you look, the diameter's the same, right? The diameters are almost all the same on these, but a much larger screen. But that meant we had to do much more to chamfer and make that LCD, really was a square LCD, but make it feel round.
Right.
Right? So that was one of the really great things. We made the sensor area even smaller, right? So that, you know, you didn't have like we have today, you know, you have your little chin on your Mac or on your iPhone the top, right? So that was really cool. Kept upgrading the connectors, all those things. But at the end of the day, you know, it was just yet again another huge leap over the Gen 2 to be able to get there. And it was literally, when you get smaller and smaller and tighter and more stuff, we had to put more temperature sensors inside. Mm-hmm. Because there was more heat, there was more, it's tighter, right? And you need to make sure you knew what the ambient temperature in the room was, not what the electronics were, because they were all tight. So there was it may seem sort of the same on the inside, but there's a lot more engineering to make it work because you're sensing things out in the environment,
right,
not inside
right.
there. Right?
So you have multiple temperature sensors so that you can sort of normalize the readings you're getting and understand what's coming from the unit and what's coming from
exactly.
the
and we had a whole set of like characterization we had to do in the lab of putting it in different settings and in different ovens and thermal chambers to then figure out and calibrate what the settings should be and where how many temperature sensors we should put on it to
yeah,
make it
yeah.
to pull it off. But you know, again, a lot of design love was put into this, even though it may seem the same, very, very different internals, which was great.
Well, this is a fantastic product. It's really fun to see something evolve like this over just the course of a few years and get so much more sophisticated as the technology improves and as you learn from the market about what people want and what's important to them. So you have a book out, Build. That's right.
Build.
Yeah.
Build. Actually, in Build, we talk about the three generations of Nest and what they meant, not just from the electronic standpoint, but what they meant from the customer and the business standpoint and why we had to do certain things the way we did and kind of the profitability of each of ones and all those kinds of things. So Build's all about being a mentor, a book of mentorship to help you build not just atoms-based products, but electron-based products. You know, just bits. It's all about building teams and building high performance teams and processes to build incredible atoms and bits or just bits products or even beyond that. And so it's a Build was a labor of love in trying to give back. You know, I had a lot of great mentors. And the only reason why I'm here today and being able to talk to all of you is because I had great mentors to help me get there. And so my mentors, many of them have died, so I wanted to give back and say, I think maybe there's some lessons learned that I took from all of them, encapsulate in the book, and then share them with the world so that it wasn't just secrets inside of one or two teams or whatever, but it's to spread that around everywhere because we all need to build and build a new, better things on this planet so that we can get past the climate crisis and these kinds of things. And it's gonna take all of us to do that. We all have to build and we have to use great tools to do it and have great teams and processes. So
great.
That's Build.
Thank you so much, Tony, for coming on. It's great to look at the process that you've gone through the eyes of these Lumafield scans and wonderful to chat with you as always.
Yeah, Lumafield is really a superpower. I always wished we had it. We could never afford anything like that at Nest. It was too expensive, but now you can if you're a startup, you can get one.
Now anyone
can have one. It's
amazing. Yeah,
it's amazing. Wish we had it then, but it's great to have it now.
All right. Thank you so much, Tony Fadell.
Thank you. Thank you so much.